Welcome back, students, to our last section of MCQs. So let us see the question. The total number of ATP produced by complete oxidation of pyruvate. So you got all your calculators going on inside your mind. The answer is not what you expected. 12.5 ATPs. So what's happened here? Now, as per the newer things, we say that each NADH will not give rise to 3 ATPs, but rather 2.5 ATPs. So whatever you had calculated, 3 plus 12, 3 from pyruvate to acetyl-CoA, acetyl-CoA through TCA cycle will give 12. So 12 plus 3 is 15. Then the 15 is luckily not an option at all. So when such a thing happens, the next thing you would be thinking is it 12? 12 comes only from TCA cycle itself. As per the old ones, as per the new ones, new calculation, each NADH will give rise to 2.5 ATPs. So from TCA cycle, we get around 10 ATPs. And 10 plus 2.5 will give rise to 12.5. So the answer which most probably comes right to is 12.5 ATPs. So remaining are also cannot happen. Remember, it is not, well, it is, they are asking of only one molecule of pyruvate and not two molecules of pyruvate. If you are calculating from glucose to 2 pyruvate to 2 acetyl-CoA, no, there was just oxidation of one pyruvate molecule, not of 2 pyruvate molecule. So your answer would be 12.5 ATPs. So let's go to the next question. Unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia is seen in all of the following except Crigler-Najjar syndrome type 1, Dubin-Johnson syndrome, Gilbert syndrome, hemolytic anemia, glucose 6-phosphate deficiency. So you are unconjugated with hyperbilirubinemia. So answer is Dubin-Johnson syndrome. Dubin-Johnson syndrome, we get conjugated hyperbilirubinemia and not unconjugated. Now what is the main thing happening in Dubin-Johnson? Please remember, this is the liver. If the uptake is deficient, we call it Gilbert. And if conjugation is deficient, bilirubin has entered. Bilirubin is going to be conjugated in two steps. First step, if it is acted, it is Crigler-Najjar type 1 and type 2. Crigler-Najjar type 1 and type 2 is because of conjugated. So conjugated bilirubin. Conjugated bilirubin is then going to be thrown into the bile. So if the defect is here, you call it as Dubin-Johnson syndrome. So if defect is here, it will be conjugated bilirubin which is going to be increased in the blood rather than unconjugated. Gilbert's, Crigler-Najjar and Dubin-Johnson's. Rota's is also there, but in that there is pigmentation also. It is not given as a choice here. So it will be Dubin-Johnson syndrome. What about Gilbert? I told you, Gilbert. Hemolytic anemias, again remember, hemolysis means more of unconjugated bilirubin. Glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency, again it is one of the causes for hemolytic anemia. Therefore, it will cause unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. So, Dubin-Johnson's will cause conjugated. So, all are true, unconjugated except Dubin-Johnson. So, let's go to the next question. The most important criteria for diagnosis of impaired glucose tolerance is fasting blood glucose more than 126 milligram percent on more than one occasion, 2-hour post-load glucose level less than 140 milligram percent, fasting blood glucose between 110 to 126 milligram percent, random blood glucose more than 200 on more than one occasion, urine Benedict's test is positive on more than one occasion. So we are talking of diagnosis of impaired glucose tolerance. So the answer is fasting blood glucose between 110 to 126. So below 110, the person is considered normal. Above 126, the person is considered as diabetic mellitus. So in between, if his fasting blood glucose is 110 to 126, we call it as impaired. But there is one more criteria in this. This is one which suits for this question. This is actually impaired fasting glycemia if only this is given. But along with that, if his 2-hour post load is between 140 to 200, then again two criteria are there for diagnosing impaired glucose tolerance. One, fasting. Fasting should be between 110 to 126 will be one criteria. The second is 2-hour post load. Post load should be between 140 to 200. So if that's the case, then you call it as impaired glucose tolerance. But if it is only fasting, only this, then you call it as impaired fasting glycemia. And this is comes less than 140, and this post load comes less than 140, you call it as impaired fasting glycemia. Now fasting blood glucose more than 126 milligram per cent, what do you call them? Diabetes mellitus. That is a criteria which is given by American Diabetic Association. 2 hours post load glucose level less than 140, that means he is normal. Normally it will be less than 140 milligram per cent. Random blood glucose level more than 200 milligram per cent on more than one occasion, again the person is considered as diabetic. Urine Benedict test is positive on more than one occasion. It doesn't have much thing to do with the diagnosis of either diabetes mellitus or of impaired glucose tolerance or impaired fasting glycemia. Why? Because urine Benedict test is not the only test which is not the test which tests for only glucose. It tests for other sugars also. So urine Benedict test is just a screening test, and it has to be preceded, it has to be followed up by blood glucose. Only then we can classify somebody as diabetic or non-diabetic or any of these other conditions also. We need the blood glucose level to classify them. So let's go to the next question. Which one of the following is the most important contributor to the blood glucose levels after 2 days of fasting? So there is two things that are happening here. They are looking after 2 days of fasting, not immediately after fasting, not within 24 hours. They are looking at nearly 48 hours of post fasting. What will happen? So most important contributor for blood glucose will come from muscle proteins and amino acids. So immediately following fasting, what will be the first source of blood glucose? It will be liver glycogen. Initially, it will be the liver glycogen which will provide the glucose, blood glucose, by glycogenolysis. Then after some time, it is gluconeogenesis which is going to take over. When gluconeogenesis is going to take over, what forms the substrate? The substrate has to come from somewhere. Gluconeogenic substrate, from where does it come? Can it come from the adipose tissue? Adipose tissue is made up of triacylglycerol, and we know that the net conversion to fats to glucose is not so adequate. So which is the next source? The next source are the skeletal muscle. The skeletal muscle is having so much of protein. All this protein can be degraded. Amino acid, glucosalanine cycle takes place, alanine, glutamine, etc. The transporters, they will transport all these amino acids to the liver, and in the liver, gluconeogenesis takes place and glucose contribution will start within 18 hours, 16 to 18 hours. Before that itself, it will have started, but at 2 days post fasting, only source will be from muscle proteins for contributor of blood glucose. Muscle glycogen cannot contribute to blood glucose. Liver glycogen, yes, but at 2 days fasting, it will be over. Non-esterified fatty acids, this fatty acids, the only thing that is possible in fatty acids is if it is an odd chain fatty acid, which is very rare. So very less contribution. So the most important contributor will be proteins. Lactate from muscle. Lactate will come from muscle. Yes, it is a substrate for gluconeogenesis. But lactate from muscle is mainly got during anaerobic metabolism. At that time, here the muscle is not having anaerobic metabolism. There is plenty supply of oxygen. So in this case, the pyruvate is not going to be converted into lactate. Rather, it will form alanine, and alanine is going to be transported. Lactate formation requires anaerobic condition, and during fasting, he is fasting, not exercising. So oxygen supply is quite good. So pyruvate will get converted to alanine, and alanine is going to be transported to the liver for gluconeogenesis. So the right answer could be muscle proteins and amino acids. So let's go to the next question. Gout is in on all except glycogen storage disease type 1, fructose intolerance, Lesch-Nihan syndrome, lactic acidosis, phenylketonuria. So what did you answer? Did you say lactic acidosis? Then you are wrong. Gout is seen in all except phenylketonuria. In phenylketonuria, usually gout is not seen. Okay, let's talk about the other. Glycogen storage disease type 1, what is that? Von Goerks. In Von Goerks, what happens? Glucose 6-phosphatase is deficient. So what? Glucose 6-phosphate increases. So what? Glucose 6-phosphate will enter into the HM patient. So it will result in the increased production of ribose, pentose. So this ribose will enter into the de novo synthesis of purine nucleotides. That means increased AMP. And increased AMP, GMP, what will happen? When there is more than what can be handled, they are going to get degraded and they will cause increased uric acid. So thereby in von Goeg's also, gout is in. Gout is what? Usually when uric acid, gout is always associated with hyperuricemia. Hyperuricemia, uric acid crystals, when they get deposited in different joints, you call it as gout, gouty arthritis. So it has gout, uric acid has to form monosodium urate crystals, and MSU crystals are the ones which are deposited in different joints. So hyperuricemia, so right now I am talking of hyperuricemia in von Goeg's disease, how it led to hyperuricemia. Fructose intolerance, why there is a hyperuricemia in this? In fructose intolerance, what's the deficiency? Aldolase B. What happens? Fructose 6-phosphate is not converted to fructose, is not going to be broken down, and it cannot enter. DHEP is not formed, glycerol 3-phosphate is not formed. So what will happen? There is a block in the metabolism of fructose 1-phosphate. Fructose 1-phosphate is not going to be converted further. So what happens? When this is blocked, fructose 1-phosphate accumulates. So what it does? It is sequestering all the inorganic phosphate into the liver hepatocyte. So that means glycogen degradation is not going to take place. Why? Glycogen phosphorylase requires inorganic phosphate for its action. So they will be characterized by this. Will what it will result? Glycogen is not there. So again, and plus at the same time for purine nucleotide synthesis, purine nucleotides, it requires phosphate. So there is no phosphate that is there to bind and form AMP or anything. So when AMP formation, whatever is formed, it will be degraded. Again, it will lead to hyperuricemia. So further, AMP is not converted to ADP. ADP is not converted to ATP. Why? There is no phosphate. All the phosphate has been sequestered by fructose 1-phosphate. So AMP is going to be degraded and it leads to hyperuricemia. Lechnian syndrome. Lechnian syndrome is due to HGPRTase, the salvage pathway. When salvage is not taking place, purines are going to be degraded. Lactic acidosis. Now, this is a very rare thing. What is happening is uric acid excretion is taking place through the kidneys. Now, lactic acidosis, whenever it is there, maybe it competes with uric acid for the same excretory mechanism. The exact mechanism is not known actually, but it has been found out that whenever there is lactic acidosis, there is decreased excretion of uric acid, thereby leading to hyperuricemia, and which can get deposited leading to gout. So all conditions which cause lactic acidosis can ultimately finally result in gouty arthritis and gout. So phenylketonuria has got none of these. So just all places gout can be seen. Let's go to the next question. Catabolism of hemoglobin results in the formation of uroporphyrinogen, takes place in mature erythrocytes, requires the enzyme hemoxygenase, results in the regulation of carbon dioxide, results in the formation of bile salts, requires the enzyme hemoxygenase. Uroporphyrinogen is a precursor. In mature erythrocytes, catabolism of hemoglobin does not take place. Why? Because the senescent RBCs have to be taken up by the spleen or the reticuloendothelial cells, and there the further action takes place of hemoglobin. First heme and globin have to be separated out, then heme has to release its iron, and then further metabolism takes place. Results in the liberation of carbon dioxide? No, it results in the liberation of carbon monoxide actually. Formation of bile pigments and not bile salts. Bile pigments are the ones which we get from heme catabolism. Biliverdin and bilirubin. So bile salts come from cholesterol, not from heme. Let's go to the next question. Black ochronotic pigmentation of cartilage is associated with deficiency of enzyme phenylalanine, hydroxylase, excretion of homocysteine acid in urine, decreased pigmentation of iris, hypothyroidism, decreased synthesis of dopamine. The answer is excretion of homocysteine acid in urine. Why? Ochronotic, where do you get it? In alkaptonuria. Homocyanticate oxidase enzyme is deficient, increased homocyanticic acid. This can get oxidized to alkaptone bodies. Alkaptone bodies are black in color and they get deposited in various tissues, including the intervertebral discs and the cartilage. Black colored ochronotic pigmentation of cartilage is usually associated, it has to be associated with excretion of homocyanticic acid, and this is a characteristic feature of alkaptonuria. Decreased pigmentation of iris is seen in deficiency of tyrosinase, where albinism, you get decreased pigmentation of iris. Hypothyroidism is again a feature of T3 tyrosine, more metabolism of tyrosine is what is affected, and when tyrosine is not formed, it can lead to hypothyroidism. Decreased synthesis of dopamine, again a feature of phenylketonuria, usually is associated with hypothyroidism or decreased synthesis of dopamine. So let's go to the next condition. In this condition, what is happening in homocyanticate oxidase? Tyrosine is normal, so all the other functions of tyrosine takes place. Only this homocyanticate pathway is the one which is affected. Let's go to the next question. Hyperammonemia is associated with elevated levels of aspargine, alanine, urea, uric acid, glutamine. Glutamine is the answer. Yes, aspargine is there, is a transporter, but to very less extent, it is not so important. Aspartate and aspargine. Alanine from muscles, true, but it is not associated with increased ammonia levels. Whenever ammonia levels increase, glutamate is converted to glutamine, and glutamine levels will be the one which will be increased. Urea, no, it is for the transport. Ammonia has to be detoxified by urea. Hyperammonemia means there is no ammonia is not being converted to urea. Uric acid has nothing to do with ammonia metabolism, rather it has to do with purine degradation. So the right answer would be glutamine. Let's go to the next question. A 40-year-old female was diagnosed to have gallbladder stones. She was initially treated with quinodeoxycholic acid, but then later underwent surgery for cholecystectomy. The rationale behind the treatment with quinodeoxycholic acid is, it interferes with the enterohepatic circulation of cholesterol. It is a competitive inhibitor of HMG-CoA reductase. It increases the formation of HDL cholesterol. It increases solubility of cholesterol in bile. It increases the formation of coprostenol. And the answer should be, it increases the solubility of cholesterol in bile. What is quinodeoxycholic acid? It is a bile salt. So when bile, when are cholesterol stones formed? When the ratio bile salts are required for keeping the cholesterol in the, solubilizing the cholesterol and prevent its aggregation and prevent the formation of cholesterol stones. Now, when you give quinodeoxycholic acid, it sees to that the ratio between cholesterol and the phospholipid is changed and cholesterol gets solubilized. Will it interfere with the enterohepatic circulation of cholesterol? No, usually it does not. They are not involved in this. There are drugs which interfere with the enterohepatic circulation of cholesterol, like cholestyramine, which bind to cholesterol and prevent its going back into the enterohepatic circulation. Competitive inhibitor of HMG-CoA reductase are usually the statins, levostatin, which acts as an inhibitor of HMG-CoA reductase. Formation of HDL cholesterol has got nothing to do with this. It increases the formation of coprostenol. Coprostenol is an end product that is got from cholesterol action of intestinal bacteria. It is the sterol that is found in feces too. So during this conversion, that means cholesterol has to be more in the intestine, only then it will can increase the formation of coprostenol. But that will not help in solubilizing the cholesterol. So to prevent the aggregation of cholesterol in the bile, in the gallbladder, and forming of cholesterol stones, quinodeoxycholic acid will help in increasing the solubility of cholesterol in bile. Though we say that cholesterol may be amphipathic because of the hydroxyl group in the third position, but cholesterol amphipathic properties are very less. Overall, it is very less. So hence, it is essential that it be solubilized. Let's go to the next question. A 5-month-old baby presented with symptoms of vomiting, night sweats and tremors. Symptoms started after introduction of fruit juices in the diet. On examination, there was hepatomegaly. Benedict's test was positive, but dipstick results for glucose was negative. The baby most likely suffers from fructokinase deficiency, aldolase B deficiency, galactokinase deficiency, galactose 1 phosphate, uridyl transferase deficiency, glucose 6 phosphatase deficiency. And your answer is aldolase B deficiency. This is hereditary fructose intolerance. Now what is happening in this? As I said, fructose 1-phosphate is not converted further. It is not broken down by aldolase B. So what it will result in the accumulation of fructose 1-phosphate. Vomiting, night sweats and tremors. Most of the night sweats and tremors are because of lack of conversion of glycogen to glucose. Now glycogenolysis requires phosphate. As I said, glycogenophosphorylase requires inorganic phosphate and it is all sequestered by fructose 1-phosphate. So hypoglycemia in the early morning, because glycogenolysis is not taking place, leading to sweating and tremors, etc., hypoglycemic symptoms. Then symptoms started after the introduction of fruit juices in the diet. That only tells you that fructose was not there in the diet. So fructose to fructose kinase, nothing was happening. So there were all started after fruit juices. So fructose is the culprit. There was hepatomegaly again because of fructose 1-phosphate accumulation. Benedict's test was positive. So many times this fructose gets excreted in the urine, leading to Benedict's positive. But dipstick for glucose will be negative because glucose is not being excreted. So most probable diagnosis is aldolase B. So with this we come to the end of all the MCQs. I wish you all the best for your examination. And all the best in studying biochemistry. Thank you.